and he tries to convince Tiberius to overturn the decision of his predecessor, Augustus, and make him king.
Herod Antipas was always very aware of who his patron was and who could give him the things he wanted. So he was very keen to stay on the right side of the Emperor Tiberius, always to be seen as flattering him and showering him with whatever benedictions he could. What he was hoping for was to be made like his father, king of the Jews.
The only person who can give him this ranking is the Emperor of Rome. And so he comes up with this plan.
Herod Antipas now builds a magnificent new city on the shores of the Sea of Galilee, just 20 miles east of Jesus' hometown.
Herod wanted to build a great city that would reflect his own grandeur, but also act as an administrative capital, the seat of Herodian power in the region.
But this new city is no mere vanity project. It is a shameless gambit to convince the new emperor to grant Herod Antipas his father's old kingdom.
And he named that city Tiberias. And that showed the people just whose patronage he enjoyed. But perhaps just as importantly, it also was an attempt to curry favor with the emperor himself.
What he's after his whole life is to become king of all the Jews. And I think he believes that by dedicating this beautiful city, maybe inviting Tiberius to come for the dedication, that he could finally achieve this goal.
But in building his monument to the new emperor, Herod Antipas also shows he is wildly out of touch with the people he yearns to rule.
One of the fascinating things that Josephus tells us about the founding of this city was that Herod Antipas built it on the site of a Jewish cemetery. Now, this was a very bad move because graves and corpses generally were regarded as impure to Jews, and anyone touching them or being near them would be made ritually unclean, and that prevented them going about certain religious duties. It shows a great deal of insensitivity towards the religious feelings of his people, but he must have been so taken up by this desire to please the emperor that he simply didn't care.
And yet, Herod Antipas's magnificent gesture goes unrewarded. The new emperor, like Augustus before him, refuses to give him the crown of Judea.
For whatever reason, Tiberius never really seems to have responded to Herod Antipas. He just wasn't listening.
Despite this bitter setback, it's not long before Herod Antipas gets another opportunity to become king of the Jews. In 19 AD, Tiberius's adopted son and darling of the people, Germanicus, unexpectedly dies from a mysterious illness.
Germanicus is sent east to Syria, and it's there, among seriously interesting circumstances, that he does become ill and dies. And immediately the charge is he was poisoned.
With Sejanus now in charge, Herod Antipas is quick to resurrect his lifelong ambition.
Every shift in the political constellation is very important to Herod Antipas. So he believes that Sejanus is about to become the big boss. He wants to ride that gravy train to the ultimate prize, king of the Jews.
The story goes, he took a trip to Rome and he fell in love. And the person he fell in love with was a Jewish woman who was in Rome at the time, married to his brother, and he talks her into, leave your husband and marry me. So that's the story we get. That's how Josephus, the historian of the time, reports it.